Now, I'm a pretty open book, somewhat to a fault. Like, I do think sometimes my family wishes I was not such an open book. I will tweet and selfie, and you know, people know what I eat usually based on looking at social media. I'm a pretty open book, but I will even admit to you, I know this to be true, that there are still sometimes things that I will hold close to my vest. You know, there are still some things about my life, as open as I am, and again, I'm pretty open. Like, I've been told, Bill, too much information, way too many times. But even I have a line that I'm like, okay, I really would rather keep this close to the vest a little bit. And what I've learned is it's stuff that surprises me sometimes, because I'm pretty wide open. But every now and then, something would be sort of like out there, and I wish I could just kind of bring it back in. You know what I mean? I don't know if you've been there before, but I was thinking about, and you saw this little shameless plug about life groups. And you're going to hear that all the time from us. It's so important to do that. Well, I had a flashback as I was thinking about this of the first life group that I was a part of, the first adult life group. We had some student life groups way before we'd had adult life groups. But in the first adult life group I had, we had known each other pretty well before we started meeting together regularly. But then, of course, as you're meeting together, you learn more and more, and you open up even more, and you know, you get to know each other really, really well. Well, we actually had, we're using a curriculum called The Five Love Languages, and I love that book. If you've never heard of it, it's great. It's really great for learning how to speak love into all the important relationships in your life, but there's actually a study about that, and we were doing that study, and I was, you know, feeling really good about leading that, and you know how awesome, that's a great truth, and we've used the truths from that book. I've used truths from that book to do some counseling, pastoral counseling. I talk about it almost every time I do premarital counseling. I will share about my love language and what I speak and blah, 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 blah. But long story short, it was during this study, I remember where it was the 1 week where we actually sort of reveal what our love language is. And I remember when my wife, Sherry, shared hers, and it was not the one that I thought it was. And it was a little thing. I could have played it down, but I was just kind of like, oh, what? That's your love language? And hers, I thought hers was the same as mine. Which actually, if you don't study it, you think everybody's is the same as yours, actually, especially the ones close to you. But mine's quality time. So the way love is spoken to me is if we hang out together, you know, let's sit down and watch our favorite show together. Let's schedule a date and go do that. Let's spend time together. I was confident that was Sherry's. And in life group, I found out that hers was actually acts of service. So all the while that I'm plopping down by her after supper, she's wishing I'd get back up and do the dishes. This was very revealing to me. And I remember not wanting to talk anymore about it in life. I'm seeing the Huguenins over there. We were in that room together. I remember it was at, I think it was at Ben Wilson's house or something. I remember thinking, I don't know if I want to talk anymore about this. I might be in trouble here, you know? And the thing that I've tried to figure out, what is that one thing you feel that caused you to be like, nope, I'm stopping right there. I don't want that to be open to other people to see. And like I said, everybody's different. I'm pretty wide open. So, I mean, there's certain things that cause me want to close the book. For others, I've got really good friends, man, that book stays closed. You got to get the key to unlock it. And you have to really get to know them before they start opening it up. So I know everybody is different. But I do think there are certain things that we really want to keep locked down. And that feeling, I've narrowed it down, that feeling that you feel that wants you to, whatever it takes, keep it down, keep it on the down low, keep it locked up, don't open it up, don't let anybody see this. That little feeling is a feeling I don't talk about a lot. It's the feeling of shame, actually. And this is what I know about us. We tend to resist allowing others to see us in ways we think are shameful. That's when we try to close it up. And that's why there are some things, some failures, that it took me a while to start opening up about, that I kept on the down low. I kept it in the history book of my life for years before I finally realized that there's healing that happens when you talk about it. And in addition to that, you might be a part of someone else's healing journey if you open up about your own past hurts and failures. And so, but we tend to resist to do that. I mean, no one wants people to see our shame, right? No one wants to see that. That's why I usually am pretty wide open until a mistake of mine is way out there. Then I want to reel that back in. Whoops, I messed up. I don't want anybody to see that. I don't want anybody to see that I was wrong, that I'd messed up. That's what I tend to want to reel back in. I'm great at being an open book when it's just about stuff, just normal stuff. But it's that shame factor. And I believe that I thought about this and I was trying to almost argue with that point. Like, is that really true or not? In fact, I was using a different word than shame when I first wrote this statement down. I thought maybe it's just that things are private, or maybe we just tend to hide our not so best traits. Maybe that's what we try to do. But that's not true. And proof of that is road rage. Because I've seen a lot of road rage. I don't know if you have or not, but I've seen a lot of road rage. And to be honest with you, I'd be ashamed to do some of the things I've seen done, even if it's not like the worst stuff. Even if there's no vulgar gestures and words used. Do you see what we look like? We're like, we're that even. Now, even if we don't do a vulgar gesture or words, it's like, how old are we? Are we really still throwing tantrums as adults, you know? But we don't mind that being out there. The reason for it is we're not ashamed of it. Because we feel it's justified. Like, yeah, I told them, how dare them go the speed limit in front of me, right? So I did the most just thing to do. I threw a tantrum in my seat at them. Yeah, that'll show them, you know? Now, I say that. I got some friends who have road rage, and I'm not trying to be all nasty. Like, we love each other. Although, one of my friends told me, the reason, Bill, you can talk about this is that you've seen a lot of road rage. You don't have it. You're the reason for it, Bill. You're the reason for the road rage. So maybe you need to look at yourself in the mirror. And there's probably some truth to that, actually. I've done a lot of this in my life. I'm so sorry. God bless you. Bless you. I think they said that back, too. So I don't know. Anyway. So here's the thing. We let people see even sometimes the side of us because we don't see it as shameful. But if it's something that is shame to us, we want that covered up. We want that bottled up. We want to keep that in. But what if God is trying to move you out of the hidden shame of your past or the hidden shame of even especially your present? And I know we can start thinking all kinds of big stuff here. And you might be sitting there saying, well, I don't know that I have any big shameful things, so this is not going to apply to me. The word shame doesn't cover just the big stuff that, you know, people would write articles about. It could be just parts of you that you don't necessarily want people seeing about you because you just don't want that seen. What if God wants to move you from that to something different in your life? And another way to say that is what we've been saying for the past couple of weeks. I believe God wants to move all of us from what is to what could be in our life, what should be even in our life. He wants to move us to His answer to those questions. So, how do we do that? Well, let me start by giving you this big, awesome Bible truth that I think you might agree with, but you still might be surprised to hear. God designed us to need helpers. I think all of us would at least agree that we all could use some help. I think maybe most of us could all agree to that, at least in theory, even if we don't live it out. But have you ever thought of the idea that God actually made you that way? God actually designed you to need helpers? Let me read to you Genesis 2:18. It says, "Then the Lord God said, 'It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him.'" This is the creation account in Genesis. And it's the only time in the entire creation account that God uttered the words, "not good." Every time He made something, He would look at it and say, "it is good." Then the next day He'd make something else. And at the end of the day, He'd look at it and He would say, "it is good." But in this one moment, He said, "not good." He saw that man was alone. And of course, we know how He fixed that. He created Eve. Even after Adam named all those animals, there was no suitable helper for him. Now, did God mess up? Did he look and say, whoops, there's a bug in the system. I'm meant to create man to never need another human being. I messed up. I guess I need to fix that bug in my system. I don't believe that. He designed us to need help. He designed us to crave it, honestly. I think that's why some of the most tragic stories, personal stories of people, usually involve loneliness. Usually involves tragic things that they became and that they did because they were loners. They had no accountability, no connection in their life. And so living life alone in their own world were able to become something that God would never want them to become. And loneliness is a very dangerous thing because God did not design us to be alone at all. He designed us to need help. James 5:16 says, therefore confess your sins to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. That's a big one. Bible very much teaches that in order for you to truly experience the healing you need in order to take next steps with God, in order to move forward in your life, another way to say it is in order to move from what is to what could be and should be in your life, there comes a time when you need to invite others in. You need to invite help into your life. In order to move from what is to what could be or should be, we need to let people see the rubble of our lives. There's hidden places that we probably all have. And inside those hidden places, there might be little things that I would say, really, you're hiding that? That's not a big deal. Or there might be hidden things you'd open up and go, oh, that's huge. I don't even know what that's like to have that in your life. There's all kinds. But we all have hidden places. I know this to be true even in our houses. And I remember once, years ago, and I fortunately know a little bit more about home maintenance now, but years ago, not long after I first moved to Independence, our air conditioner stopped working. And I did know well enough to check the breaker and, you know, make sure things were plugged in, but it wasn't kicking on at all. So I made a phone call and the person came out, and I found out what they were going to have to do was go into the room where the pump is, which is in our laundry room. Now, I don't know what your all's laundry rooms are like, but that is a very important room in our house. When we know somebody's coming over, we throw everything in that room and we shut that door. And you will not get in that door. My wife is a very sweet person, but you might lose a body part if you go towards that room and touch that doorknob. And no, you can't go in there. But that used to be where we'd throw things in and hide our dirty laundry and whatever junk and clutter and all that. Well, now this guy was coming to fix our air conditioner to get inside that room. So, of course, we spiffied up the junk room so that we wouldn't be embarrassed for him coming to see that. And anyway, while he was in there working on it, I was like, hey, so I bet you see a lot of weird stuff at these houses. He says, you have no idea. I thought, okay, good. Well, hopefully this is okay. But long story short, there was a little light switch I didn't even know hardly existed that you flip on and it makes the AC work. And that's how he fixed it. That was $50 I wish I'd had back right there. But here's the thing, is like I remember we had to prepare to hide the stuff we were ashamed of for him to come and fix something that was broken. And when you really think about it, just saying that out loud, it's in our very lives, how can we get fixed? How can we get help if we don't allow the people wanting to help us to see where the brokenness is? And yet we tend to keep those things closed up. We tend to do that. Now, that brings us to where we've been in the Bible for the past couple of weeks on this journey called Under Construction. We've been looking in the book of Nehemiah. We're going to be in chapter 3 for just a little bit this morning, so feel free to turn there or bring out your smartphone or your tablet and swipe and gesture there if you want. But we're in Nehemiah 3. We're going to look at the last 5 verses of that. But to sort of recap a little bit, Nehemiah experienced an event that shook him. He had actually literally had a conversation that shook him to his core. He was in Persia, the cupbearer to the king, and he got a report back from one of his fellow Jews that Jerusalem was in a state of desolation. his hometown. The walls were down. It had been burned. The place was ruined. The people that were a remnant still living there were depressed. They were being ridiculed by the other nationalities that lived around them. It was a shameful time in the life of Israel. They were experiencing real shame in their lives. And so that earth-shaking event caused him to do this one step that we talked about in week one, and that was meet with the architect. If you're going to do any kind of construction, you should meet with an architect, meet with an expert who knows what they're doing. And this is what Nehemiah did all in chapter one of that book. He prayed. He met with the grand architect, the architect of the universe, the architect of his very body, of his very soul, and he prayed about what to do next. And then the second thing that we learned last week in chapter 2 is this concept of beginning with the end. Nehemiah, through praying and through taking the next step, obeying the blueprint that God gave him, he began with the end. The vision that God gave him, the end vision, was a wall around Jerusalem that was rebuilt once again. That was the end. And Nehemiah began with that end. And because he began with that end, he took bold steps. He talked to the king about going back to Jerusalem. And not only that, he boldly, by God's leadership, he boldly asked this pagan king, who probably had put a ban on even building the wall, he asked that king to foot the bill for it, to provide the materials for it, to make the way possible. And the king agreed to do that. So meet with the architect. Begin with the end. In this series, this six-week series, we're going to give you six things to do to move from what is in your life to what could be and what should be. And the same is true for our church. Our church as a whole needs to be asking those same questions. We don't want to stay stuck in what is. We want to move towards what could be and what should be, because we don't want to settle for what we think is okay, especially knowing that 85% of the people outside these walls this morning don't attend church, perhaps don't even know about this Jesus who died for them. So let me look with you in Nehemiah chapter 3, and we're going to see what that kind of next thing is. I'm going to go ahead and give it to you. Spoiler alert. Here's the third thing that you must do. Meet the construction crew. Meet the construction crew. In fact, I'll be honest with you, Nehemiah 3 is one of the least exciting chapters in the Bible, actually. It's really cool. You read Nehemiah chapter 1, and Nehemiah feels burdened and passionate about building those walls, and he prays. And in chapter 2, he's talking to the king, and he goes and inspects the wall, and he starts rallying the people. We're going to build this wall. Yeah, it's awesome. Then in chapter 3, it names everybody that helped with the wall. So I just thought I would look at the last five verses of this, starting in verse 28. It says, above the horse gate, the priests repaired, each one opposite his own house. I love that picture of this. What's another beautiful sermon in this is preaching on what the body of Christ looks like, which is taught about in 1 Corinthians 12, how everybody does their part. And here, you just walk out of your house, and there's a portion of the wall in ruins. Well, there's my job. I'll just walk across my yard to the wall, and I'll rebuild that part of the wall. And that's what you see happening here, is people pitching in together. It's really cool. So above the horse gate, the priest repaired, each one opposite his own house. After them, Zadok, the son of Immer, repaired opposite his own house. After him, Shemaiah, the son of Shechaniah, the keeper of the east gate, repaired. After him, Hananiah, the son of Shelemiah, and Hanan, the sixth son of Zalaph, repaired another section. After him, Meshulam, the son of Berechiah, repaired opposite his chamber. After him, Malchijah, one of the goldsmiths, repaired as far as the house of the temple servants and of the merchants, opposite the muster gate, and to the upper chamber of the corner. And between the upper chamber of the corner and the sheep gate, the goldsmiths and the merchants repaired. And that doesn't sound like memory verses we want to memorize, because they give us these warm fuzzies, right? That's not a warm fuzzy chapter. The whole chapter's like that. Actually, I looked back on it, and I'm glad I chose those last five verses to read, because some of those names and the other ones are pretty tough to pronounce, and I'm sure I butchered those too, actually. But this is what we see happening. If we all pitch in, we can accomplish God's vision for each other and this church. That's the simple truth of this entire chapter. We all need a construction crew. Every one of us in our lives need a construction crew. And I would say your personal reconstruction and this church's reconstruction cannot happen unless we all pitch in together. And you heard me mention life groups. You've heard us talk about that. This is where I see this really, really ring true. When someone, we find out in this church that someone is maybe having surgery or having gotten sick and has to go to the hospital, I can't tell you how many times I've gone and that person, I'm thinking, I need to go see this person, see how they're doing, and maybe try to minister to them. And when I get there, their life group has already been there. I already prayed with them. They've already set up a meal schedule, bringing meals to their house. And, hey, what are you doing here, Bill? You know, it's like, hey, I'm just the pastor here, so I'll check on you. It's really cool. I love it. It's awesome. And I can't tell you how many times I've heard people say, when I went through, fill in the blank, I don't know what I would have done if I did not have my church family, my spiritual family, my small group. I've heard it a gazillion times. And it's because of that, and that's only one of the reasons, but certainly because of that reason, that I am diehard about people inviting others in and making a personal commitment to open up their lives to others, to allow people to be a part of their lives, to help, to get to know each other, to be a part of a life group. I will not stop mentioning it. And it's interesting. Sometimes, and you know, for those of you who've been here for decades at Hickory Grove, it sometimes feels like that's a new ministry. Like, oh, we used to have, you know, classes more than groups. And I have had conversations like that. And I'm telling you, all you have to do is look in Acts chapter 2. Small groups, life groups, community groups, a lot of churches call them different names. It's still groups. They existed in the first century. This is not a new ministry. This is a very old ministry that still works. But in addition to that, some of the people say, man, you talk too much about that. The ones who say that to me, they have it already. It's just they don't realize how long they've had it, that we've taken it for granted. The reason I talk about it so much is because I want you to know that if you don't have that group, that you need it. And you need to do whatever it takes to pry open your life and let help come in. And it's not as hard as you think it is. And we'll talk about that more in just a little bit. But the bottom line is everyone needs family. Everybody needs family. And I would tell you, I've heard many stories where it's great if you have a biological family that you're just there for each other all the time and you meet together regularly and you're wide open with each other and you're helping each other take next steps spiritually. And that's great and that's awesome. But we need our spiritual family too. And for some people, if it were not for the spiritual family, there would be no family that they even have, that they readily have access to. So that's why this is so important. Let me say it another way. We need people who can see the rubble of our lives, yet they stick around. That's huge. That's what spiritual family is. That's what church family ought to be. That's what your small group, your life group should be. Where they see the rubble of your lives. They see the cracks in the wall. They see the things that maybe you would normally try to keep hidden. But these folks that you've begun to talk to and have conversations with, you've begun to open up a little bit and let them see some of those hidden places in your life, some of those hidden places in your heart. And they're not running. They are glad that they could see that. And by the way, here are my hidden places too. And let's come before the Lord together and let's pray about those things. Let's talk about those things. Let's hold each other accountable. Let's encourage one another. Let's equip one another. I'm here to tell you, when you start doing that, friends, there's nothing like it. And I know that because probably for the first decade of my Christian walk, I did not have this. There's a difference between sitting in rows like this and learning a lot of information about God and trying to apply it to your life than actually butting up your life against someone else's life and trying to do that together. There's something wonderful and beautiful about it. There's a camaraderie that results. There's a family that is birthed. And then once you have it, you know you'll never want to let it go. So, that's why I say one of the most important steps you can take in your life, and one of the most important steps we can take as a church, is meet the construction crew in our life. We need to have a team of people that are get on that wall with us together. And that's why we use the word together a lot here. That's why when we talk about those four G's, we do those things together. We talk about gathering for worship. We gather together, just like you did this morning. We grow together in groups. We give together. Just meat giving is okay. That's great. But as we all give of our time and of our talent and of our treasure together, God does something amazing. We, all of us, get on that wall together, not just one, but all of us get on that wall together and start doing our part. We all pitch in together. Something amazing is constructed. And I'm not talking about just the church. I'm talking about in your heart, in your life. And not only do we gather together and we grow together and we give together, we go together. We go invite others and invest in others. We go be a part of reaching out in this community together so that others can know this Jesus who has changed us. Now let me shift gears for a moment and let's talk about the church. We talk about being under construction. Let's talk about our campus a little bit. We've been sort of revealing this piece by piece over the past few weeks. I believe confidently that God has given me a vision for what God's going to do on this campus, on our property. It began with us realizing that what is not good enough, especially as we looked at our kids' ministry area. We were like, wow, we got three different check-in locations, and a couple of the spaces that our kids are using are a couple of the oldest spaces that we have. And this is where we're inviting our families to come and be a part of. I'm here to tell you, demographics show very clearly, we're surrounded with young families that are unchurched. But if you invite them, if I invite them, they'll come check us out. But we were getting literal data, literal people saying to us, I came and checked it out. That was a rough experience with my kids. Three different check-in locations. I'll show them to you, actually. Here were some of the check-in locations. Here's one. This is right out in the foyer. Here's one location right there. It's funny because I took this picture and forgot to turn the lights on. It makes it look eerie. I didn't mean for it to look eerie. I got the door you don't want to go through in the movies. This is the door you say, don't go in there. That's not the case here. I just forgot to turn the lights on. But that's right there. If you go out in the foyer and turn right, that's one check-in area. That's where our youngest folks are. This was another one right downstairs below that entrance. If you go downstairs, this area, for those who've been around here a long time, we called it the blue room because it was electric blue in color because we didn't change the carpet and the wall color for a really long time when it was first built. But we changed it and really did the best we could in that room. If you were to go in there and seen it before and after, we did the best we could, but it's still the oldest place we put people in. And it's like, the ceiling's like 6 foot tall. It's perfect for little kids. The workers are ducking to go in there, but we had that space. And then the third space is currently where our kids' worship area is, right over here. And this is where, if you're here today, you brought children with you, that's where you were this morning. So now here's the good news. Moving from what is to what could be, there are some things you can do now without having to call an architect. When the Lord reveals it very quickly, we did some research and realized we can fit the kids that are down there in there. And so we had to do a little tweaking to make it happen. So this other entrance here is gone. And we hung this beautiful graphically designed poster board to tell you that do not come here. It was funny because I thought, hey, maybe for extra measure, I'll go in there and take some pictures to show you what that was like in there, and not that it was going to be necessary. And it was locked. Like, we're like, we're locking that room. You're not going in there anymore. And I thought, you know what? I'm going to leave it locked. That's okay. But anyway, so moving forward, I want to give you a vision of moving from what could be to what should be. We talked about consolidating our space, which does a couple things. It makes it very easy for any family to come on our campus to know where to go when they first get here. We don't want there to be a logistical barrier to families who've never been to church before to know where to go. Not only that, when there's one obvious entrance to where you go with your kids, that's secure, that's safe. I'm here to tell you, that's number one priority for our kids' ministry, to be safe and to be secure and to do whatever it takes to give all of our parents that obvious feeling that, okay, I don't have to worry about where my kid is. So this is the lobby of our gym when you first walk into. So in the future, when we get our remodeling done, our phase one of remodeling done, it's going to be very obvious when you come on our campus that if you have children or students, that you walk into the main entrance of the other building out there, that main entrance that says gym and office out there. And this is what it looks like right now when you walk in there. But here's what could be and what should be when you walk in there. This is what our remodel will look like. And it's honestly not the most drastic thing ever. It's amazing what a coat of paint and new flooring and a little bit of furniture can do to make it way more inviting to families as they walk in. And what's also cool is after phase one, this isn't shown on there, but some of the stuff we're doing in that area, you'll be able to see through some glass windows and see a play area for kids, where as soon as you walk in, you realize and know that, wow, this is a place where kids and families are welcome. We want you here, and we have a fun and safe place for you to be. But then upstairs, and we'll show you the current upstairs, this is the top floor of the Family Life Center, the other building across the way here. This is what it looks like now. It's a hallway with different rooms that we use for adult education space. If you haven't heard the full story, we're turning even that floor into all kids' space as well. And so all of our adult education space is going to be moving over here to this nursery wing. We'll try to change those doors so they don't look so eerie when the lights are out, but that's going to be all adult education space with completely remodeled bathrooms, where the bathrooms are bigger and nicer. I'm waiting for an amen, but I haven't heard it yet. I did not realize there was a tiny miniature toilet in the women's room over there till we walked through with the architectural team. Like, that is a small toilet. It makes sense because that is the nursery wing. I mean, I knew there was a shorter one. I just didn't know it was that short. But anyway, so all that's going to be remodeled too, by the way, for you adults who are used to enjoying this wing. We'll have all the adults over there. But then this is what it's going to look like after the remodel. Once we remodel it, you can see all the wonderful check-in technology that is up there. It's like an upper lobby for the kids. And all of those rooms that are down that hall and either another room that's going to be built is going to be all for kids. It's going to be very obvious and very easy. There's one way in, one way out. It's going to be safe. It's going to be secure. It's going to be a lot nicer for our families. I'm super excited about this. I believe that this is what God has in store for us, and it's urgent. It's very urgent because God has already opened up doors and shown us favor to reach young families for Christ. And if we pitch in together and get on this, I believe that we can move from what is to what could be and should be. And I know it's crazy, it sounds, okay, it's remodeling, Bill. But I'm here to tell you, by us doing this, it's all about the mission. We're not doing this just to look nicer. That's fine, that's good, that's great. But the reason we want it to be this is to effectively reach families for Christ. For when they bring families on this campus, they're not walking into a weird, eerie, creepy old place that even as best you can try to make it look clean, it just doesn't. Three different ways to get in and not sure how to get from all of them in a timely way. By the time you sit down in one of these seats, you're exhausted as a parent. Instead, we want to do whatever it takes to help every person take their next step with Jesus. That means removing as many barriers as you can. This removes tons of barriers, and I'm super excited about it. But we can't do it without our construction crew. I need my construction crew, and that's you. No, we're not going to put a hammer or a paintbrush in your hand at all. Not at all. This is not going to be a volunteer project at all. But I need you to be my construction crew to be praying for this. Praying for God's timing, provision, for Him to make that path straight. We need you to be encouragers and supporters as we move forward together in this vision. And yes, we need you to be givers too, as Matt just wonderfully communicated, you know, to begin somewhere. Even just by you giving of that first starting point, a tithe, will help make this possible. You're going to hear us ask about even more sacrificial giving, giving above and beyond that, directly to this vision, directly to this project. We need that, and we won't be able to accomplish it without that. You'll be hearing more about that in the coming weeks and costs and all that. But the point is this. We can't do this without our construction crew. All of us pitching in with prayer and support and giving. And I will tell you this, I said this last week, if we're not all gathering, growing, giving, and going, if we're not doing that, There's no need for us to even begin this vision. Because God is way more interested in building people than in building plans. If we're not actively trying to make sure our hearts are reconstructed, that we are personally, all of us personally, moving from what is to what could be in our lives, and we don't even need to be looking at blueprints for our church campus. I believe He's on the move right now, reconstructing in both areas. I believe it with all my heart. And I can't wait to see what He's going to do. So, as we close our time together, I want to leave you with one simple thing, because if you're sitting where I'm, you know, I'd be sitting where you're sitting, I'd be thinking, well, then what do I do next? What's the next thing I need to do? Let me backtrack. We're shifting gears back to you having your construction crew in your life. How do you do that? If you're sitting there and you don't have that, you hopefully are asking that. What do I do to get that? I'm going to give you something very simple to remember. Begin a conversation. That's it. Just begin a conversation. As sometimes the hardest step is to start, but that's a great starting point. What can that look like? Well, I'm going to give a shameless plug. It could be you saying, hi, my name is Bill, and I want to sign up for Grove 101 because this church family seems pretty cool and I want to be a part of it. You heard us talk about that and announce that. A little new members, new attenders class that we're doing a week from today. Sign up for it. There's a conversation right there. Just begin by signing up for that. Or how about that Group Connect event that you heard Matt talk about, January 29th. Maybe your first conversation is, hi, my name is Bill, and I'm here for Group Connect. Awesome, we're glad you're here. When you leave here tonight, you're going to be in a group. That's easy. And if for some crazy reason you're not in a group, but you have to miss that night, and even if you're not, let me give you some other examples. Begin doing life with people is inviting them into your life. And it can be just a simple conversation that you start that says, hi, my name is Bill. How long have you come to church here? Hi, my name is Bill. How are you today? Hi, my name is Bill. It's been fun getting to know you. Want to grab a cup of coffee together sometime? Hi, my name is Bill, and I've been hearing that boring guy talk about life groups for the past few weeks. I'm thinking about starting one. Are you in one? If they say no, you want to come be a part of mine? Maybe that conversation isn't necessarily with someone here. Maybe it's with a coworker, maybe with a neighbor. Hey, my church is doing this thing where we get together in homes and, you know, get to know each other better. And I'd love for you to be a part of that. You just have to try it for 5 weeks, 6 weeks. Would you want to come? All relationships begin with a conversation.
Amen.
All of them begin. But it's up to you to start it. And someone might start it with you, and maybe your conversation that you begin is just finally saying, sure. Okay. I'll grab a cup of coffee with you. Okay, I'll try your small group. Okay, I'll come to the Group Connect event. Maybe that's all you actually have to say, because God has already laid it upon someone's heart to begin a conversation with you. And you just have to respond, okay, I'll give it a try. I'm here to tell you, friends, you were not designed to go it alone. You are not supposed to do that. God didn't call you to do that. Invite someone in. How are you going to begin a conversation? You need a construction crew. My question for you today is, have you met yours yet?